Hey guys, Kurt and Matt here. About a month ago, we asked you what storyline or event you want us to take a closer look at, and you selected Flashpoint.
It's important to note, though, that we're reviewing the comic book event from summer 2011, and not the DC animated movie Flashpoint Paradox.
That Flashpoint Paradox movie is based on the comics, but again, for this video, we're going to be looking at the comic series and its various tie-ins.
DC's Flashpoint is a five-issue event that centers around Barry Allen, the Flash. As a child, his mother was killed by his time-traveling adversary, Eobard Thawne, the Reverse Flash. While this death had a tremendous impact on Barry's life, he still grew up and became a superhero. He got married and had a loving family, and of course, he made powerful friends, like the Justice League. The Flashpoint event begins with Barry waking up from a nap at work. Hearing of a threat to the city, Barry runs off to deal with it. Unfortunately, he doesn't realize his connection to the Speed Force is gone. He doesn't have superpowers. After accidentally tumbling down the stairs, Barry is shocked to see his mother. She's alive and part of his life. While Barry is happy with this new development, he realizes something is seriously wrong. From past experience, he knows that Batman is the one man who can help him figure everything out. Borrowing his mother's car, Barry drives to Gotham City. Meanwhile in Gotham, the Dark Knight is still cleaning up crime. Yet the reader is shocked when Batman tosses a criminal off a building with the intent to kill. Fortunately, Cyborg, who is now America's greatest hero, catches the villain in time. Cyborg has come to Gotham to recruit Batman to his new metahuman team. The world is in danger, and he needs everyone's help. In this world, the biggest superpowers are Atlantis, led by Aquaman, and the Amazons, led by Wonder Woman. The two nations are at war and are destroying the entire world in the process. The Amazons claim the United Kingdom as their new homeland, while Atlantis responded by sinking Western Europe into the ocean, killing millions. Cyborg wants to build a metahuman team to oppose the forces of Wonder Woman and Aquaman. Many heroes, like Captain Thunder as he is called in this universe, are ready to fight, but they all want Batman to lead them. Most of them are in awe of Batman's legend. However, Batman declines to join and the group falls apart. Cyborg angrily points out that war will destroy the entire world, including Gotham. Batman responds saying, "One can only hope." Elsewhere, Barry has made it to Wayne Manor, and uses his knowledge to enter the Batcave. There he finds a much different setup than he expected. Suddenly, he is attacked from behind by Batman, who demands to know why he was there. Barry begs Bruce to stop, but Batman says that Bruce is dead. Barry is shocked to realize that in this universe it wasn't Thomas and Martha Wayne who died in Crime Alley, it was Bruce. Barry tries to explain that he is the Flash, but Batman only sees him as a delusional idiot. As Batman tosses him around, Barry experiences a sudden memory shift. His memories of the old universe are beginning to be replaced by memories from this new timeline. He discovers that he still has his costume ring, though. When he tries to use it, the costume of the Reverse Flash, Eobard Thawne, comes out. Barry concludes that Thawne must have used his time travel abilities to create this new timeline. Thomas Wayne cares only about one detail, though. What happened to Bruce and Barry's timeline? Barry tells him how Bruce is his ally and friend, and Thomas finally seems to gain some hope. He asks Barry how they can restore the original timeline. Barry responds saying that he needs the Speed Force. He plans to recreate the conditions that originally gave him his powers, a mixture of chemicals and a jolt of lightning. A skeptical Thomas Wayne watches as a bolt of lightning zaps Barry, but instead of gaining a connection to the Speed Force, he is severely burned. Thomas tends to his wounds, and a barely alive but resolute Barry asks to try again. He needs to regain his powers before his memories fade away completely. Strapped back onto the lightning rod, a massive lightning bolt unexpectedly strikes Barry and sends Thomas flying. This time it works. Barry regains his powers and catches Batman. While his healing factor kicks in, Barry constructs a new costume and plans his next step with Thomas. Barry wants to turn to those he knew as the Justice League. However, in this world, Hal Jordan is not a Green Lantern. He never received the ring from Avin Sur and is still a test pilot. There is also no record of Superman's existence. Thomas, however, recalls a rocket crash in Metropolis. In this world, Superman crashed there as a baby and was recovered by the United States government. With no way of knowing where he is now, Batman decides to turn to Cyborg for help. In exchange for helping them locate Superman, Batman agrees to join Cyborg's metahuman team. Cyborg locates a secret government installation under Metropolis, which houses Subject One, the alien the government recovered from the Metropolis crash site. The three break in and make their way to a giant vault that they assume holds the Man of Steel. Yet when they open the door, all they see is a scrawny pale man. As they break him out, they realize that he has been held as a science experiment his entire life. his powers never developed because he never received any sunlight. When they make their way outside, Superman finally speaks as he sees the sun for the first time. His powers immediately begin to manifest and he begins to levitate. By this time, the base's soldiers have all been mobilized. Batman tells Superman to take them down. Instead, Superman simply flies away. The Flash, Batman, and Cyborg are left facing a squadron of soldiers. Fortunately for them, Element Woman shows up and saves the day. Unfortunately, Flash begins to experience seizures as his memories of the old timeline continue to fade. Elsewhere, the world continues to descend into chaos. Atlantean forces led by Emperor Aquaman patrol European waters where marauding pirates, like Deathstroke, pillage the wasteland of Western Europe. In London, Wonder Woman and her Furies extract information of a growing underground resistance from Steve Trevor. Since the Amazons and Atlanteans have begun open warfare in the UK with both leaders and their armies jumping into the fray, the President of the United States dispatches a fleet of fighter jets led by Hal Jordan to drop advanced nuclear weapons on London in hopes of killing both Wonder Woman and Aquaman. While the American plan is put into motion, Batman, Cyborg, and Element Woman take Flash to the Batson family to help control his seizures. The Batson children are actually able to combine into Captain Thunder when they all shout Shazam together. Batman believes their magical abilities can help recover Barry's memories. When Billy Batson touches Barry, he receives the memory of the Billy from the original timeline, where only he was Captain Marvel. He uses his powers to stabilize the Flash. In the Batson living room, a news report describes a massive defeat Hal Jordan and the American pilots suffered at the hand of the Amazon fleet of invisible planes. Cyborg uses his satellite imaging to see an Atlantean superweapon that could sink the entire world into the ocean, likely destroying the world in the process. In his desire to help others no matter what timeline he is in, Barry declares that they must go stop Emperor Aquaman and Wonder Woman. Batman disagrees. Thomas argues that anyone they save will be wiped away anyways when the original timeline is restored. He declares that they either change the timeline or let this world burn in hell. The Flash is resolute and he joins with Cyborg's group to go stop the conflict. Batman begrudgingly comes along. The conflict is well underway when the heroes arrive. The Batson children immediately change into Captain Thunder and go after Wonder Woman. She scarred his face in past conflict. However, one of the metahumans on Cyborg's team, Enchantress, is actually a mole for Wonder Woman. She uses her magical abilities to separate Captain Thunder and revert them back into children. With the kids now vulnerable, Wonder Woman's sister, Penethelia, drives a sword through Billy Batson, killing him. Barry doesn't have time to mourn though. Eobard Thorne, the Reverse Flash, suddenly appears saying, "Look at what you did." Barry immediately blames Thawne for manipulating the time stream. However, Thawne merely taunts him, saying that Barry has forgotten the truth. While gloating, Thawne returns some of Barry's memories and Barry realizes that it isn't Thawne who created this new timeline, it was him. Barry used the Speed Force to travel back in time and stop Thawne from killing his mother. This created a brand new timeline where he would no longer become the Flash. The world of Flashpoint is this timeline. An angry Barry begins to fight as Reverse Flash taunts him. Thawne brags how the changes Flash made benefited him. In the past, Reverse Flash couldn't kill Barry because if he did, then he would cease to exist. However, now Thawne is a living paradox. He can do whatever he wants to the time stream. He defeats Barry and stands over him in triumph, continuing to gloat. Thawne is oblivious as Batman drives a sword through his chest. Even though Reverse Flash has been defeated, the cataclysmic war is still going on. The world is still about to be destroyed by the Atlantean superweapon. More players from the different Flashpoint tie-in series, like the British Resistance, appear. The traitor, Enchantress, is now trying to kill the other vulnerable Batson children. However, Superman arrives in a blaze of glory and simply squashes her. He says, "No more," and then takes on both Aquaman and Wonder Woman. Even though Superman seems to be turning the tide in favor of the heroes, the world is still beginning to be split in half. With Barry not knowing what to do next, a dying Batman tells him to take a letter for his son Bruce and simply run. Barry starts to run as fast as he possibly can, drawing the Speed Force into himself. As he runs, he realizes to set things back to the way they were, he must allow his mother to be killed. He goes to see her one last time and explains the situation to her. She tells him that he has to let her go, regardless of how painful it is. With that, Barry continues to run. He stops his past self from running back in time to save his mother and keeps running. As the timeline begins to be restored, we see a mysterious figure who tells him that the three previously shattered universes are being reformed into one. The event ends with Barry once again waking up from a nap at work. He runs off, and this time, he is the Flash. He goes to visit Batman, who is once again Bruce Wayne, and explains to him the entire ordeal in the Flashpoint timeline. He regrettably says that his memories from the timeline are slowly beginning to fade away. Before they do, though, he gives Bruce the letter Thomas gave him. The letter emotionally rocks Bruce, bringing him to tears. The final page of Flashpoint shows Bruce giving Barry a rare smile, saying, "You're one hell of a messenger."
That last scene with Batman and Flash in the letter is such a fitting and touching ending to this whole event, especially because I would say that Flash and Batman are arguably the two most central characters.
Obviously, Flash is more important because he's the one who broke the timeline and then also fixed it. But I also liked how as the event progressed, we didn't realize that it was Flash saving his mother, which destroyed the timeline. Initially, all the way up until like Flashpoint number 4, you think it was the Reverse Flash who was the cause of everything.
Exactly. You didn't think that Flash was the one that messed everything up.
Because he's a hero. Heroes don't mess things up.
And I like the steady progression of him just seeing his memories come back. Throughout the event, you'd have these splash pages of events that happened because of this change. And it was such a great way to learn more about the Flash character now, see what the changes are, and it allowed us to see his entire history, basically.
When you talk about those flashes, I think they also added a sense of urgency, because his previous memories would be slipping away from him, and you could see, A, how painful that was for him to like lose his relationships with all his friends, like the Justice League. And it really made you think, like, the clock is ticking before things can't be reversed.
I really like Thomas Wayne's line to him as he's dying, which is just to run. He knows that time is slipping away, and he needs to just run to fix it all as quickly as possible, and that's what the Flash does.
The best part is, you know, catching himself and then being forced to let his mother die in order to save everyone. Like, that's the sacrifice, that's the penance he has to pay. And it's pretty emotional.
It is emotional, but at the very end, we see that he still retains some of those memories from that previous life.
No, briefly, though.
Briefly, but even that brief moment is a gift, as Batman says.
Yeah, I think he also knew that he had to pay that price. Like, he had to let his mother go, because he saw what the world of Flashpoint was and how the world couldn't be that way. I think at a certain point during the course of the event, when Batman is laying out their plan, he's like, "I don't care about saving the world of Flashpoint. I just care about restoring the timeline to the way it should be." He goes, "Our world's already doomed, so we either let it burn or restore your timeline." But speaking of the changes in the world of Flashpoint, there were some pretty major things that happened. Obviously, the biggest was the Atlantean-Amazon War.
This war, a lot of the details can be found within the tie-in specifically, Wonder Woman and the Furies, and Emperor Aquaman.
The story starts with Diana when she was young. She decides to leave Paradise Island and venture out into the world. In the ocean, she comes across a kraken. Also, there is a young Arthur who realizes she isn't a damsel in distress who needs saving. A whirlwind romance occurs, and the two become engaged. The Atlantean and Amazonian empires want to use this alliance as an opportunity to reveal themselves to the world and promote peace. Unfortunately, on the day of their wedding, Diana's mother is killed. It turns out not every Amazonian and Atlantean is pleased with this marriage. Aquaman's brother Orm and Wonder Woman's aunt, Penethelia, feel the marriage would ruin the proud histories of their great civilizations. They manipulate events to drive the two empires to war. Penethelia orders Artemis to kill the queen, and Orm helped frame Garth as the assassin. When Emperor Aquaman attempts to atone and sue for peace, Penethelia destroys Paradise Island to make it look like an Atlantean attack. With her homeland destroyed, Wonder Woman is no longer open to peace. Things get even worse when Orm encourages Aquaman's new wife, Mira, to challenge Diana. Although a formidable warrior, Mira is simply no match for Wonder Woman and is instantly defeated. When he receives Mira's head in a box, Aquaman is also forced to give up on peace. As the war intensifies, a metahuman arms race erupts. The Markov family of Markovia become valuable commodities. The royal family possesses the power to manipulate the gravitational field of Earth. Atlanteans capture Brian Markov and turn him into a superweapon that they use to sink Europe. New Themyscira is spared because Brian's sister Terra aligned with the Amazonians. Her powers were the only thing stopping what was left of Britain from sinking into the ocean. Just before the final battle of Flashpoint began, Wonder Woman discovered the secret alliance between Orm and Penethelia. After learning the truth, she attempts to persuade Aquaman to end the war. Sadly, he is unable to forgive her for the death of Mira. Arthur and Diana are unable to go back and must fight till the end.
Those tie-ins really added so much to the event. I mean, you didn't get to see a lot of the Aquaman-Wonder Woman story in the main event, since I mainly dealt with Flash and Batman. But, I mean, their story was, like, it was so tragic at times.
It was very tragic. I liked the politics that were involved with it, because It was two very powerful mythical nations, essentially, coming out to the world and then basically ravishing the world. And I thought that storyline itself was...
Well, it was more like the world was just collateral damage in
That's
there.
True. And because they were such warrior nations, it was more of just personal vendetta that spread out and affected everyone else. But initially, they started off with such noble intentions of coming out to the world together and furthering their own causes of Aquaman's people were angry at the pollution that was happening over the last century. And, you know, Wonder Woman realized that for their nation to grow, they needed to come out to the world as well.
And just looking at those two characters specifically, their story was almost like such a tragic love story, is that like they met each other when they were young and they maybe actually did love each other, but their siblings just screwed it up for them.
Their entire interaction was a lot like a Greek tragedy, I think. They had a lot of family members that were, you know, interfering. There was a lot of duplicity, and at the same time, the main characters were the ones that were the real...
victims.
Exactly.
They were almost forced into their roles. Like, they didn't want to fight each other. Even in their final confrontations, their hearts didn't really seem to be into it. It's almost like they wished things would have turned out a different way.
Since they weren't really certain in their leadership roles, they turned to their close advisors, which were Orm and Penthesilea, and they both kind of led them astray.
Well, obviously, those two wanted the thrones for themselves.
Their plan basically required both of their nations to be weakened to a point where they would be the next leaders, and then they would join forces at that point. But at that point, they're weakened nations.
And the world is destroyed.
Exactly. So I wasn't really fully behind what they were planning on doing.
Yeah, they didn't really seem to have an endgame. Still, that Atlantean-Amazon war was just such a huge event in the world of Flashpoint. And the Flash obviously couldn't turn for the two of them for help, so he had to look for other Justice League members. As the first person you gotta go to is Superman, but of course, Superman is different in this world too. Incredibly painful for him as well. A lot of that's detailed in his tie-in as well, which is Project Superman.
The tie-in actually begins with the soldier Neil Sinclair, who volunteers for a government super soldier program. He gains superpowers and becomes the ultimate soldier, codenamed Subject Zero. As his powers grow, he proves himself to be an unstoppable killer. Unfortunately, he begins to lose his humanity, his sense of right and wrong. General Lane, his commanding officer, has no choice but to lock Subject Zero away. The government's desire for a Superman doesn't end there, though. When an alien rocket crashes in Metropolis, they gain a new test subject. The boy inside becomes Subject One. Yet General Lane grows to care for him, even calling him Kal. Like a caring father, Lane lets him play with his alien dog, Subject Two. But the captured Subject Zero attempts to exploit Kal and manipulates the situation so the dog is killed. In his grief, Kal escapes his cell and frees Subject Zero, who proceeds to go on a rampage. Kal wanders into General Lane's office, where he meets his daughter Lois. Subject Zero also arrives, since he wants to kill Lois to punish General Lane for imprisoning him. Before he can hurt either Kal or Lois, General Lane arrives to protect both of his children. He engages Subject Zero and locks them both into the Phantom Zone. With Lane gone, General Atom takes over and takes a new approach to Project Superman. He simply locks Subject One away. With no one left to look out for him, Kal is left only with the memory of the girl he briefly met. The story of Project Superman continues after the Flash breaks Superman out. The damage done to the facility also reopens the portal to the Phantom Zone. Subject Zero is released and still looking to kill Lane's children. Kal, meanwhile, flew to Britain to find Lois Lane. The two are briefly reunited before Subject Zero arrives. He and Kal battle as two of the strongest beings on the planet. In the end, Kal wins and the day is seemingly saved. Sadly, Lois was mortally wounded in the process. Before she dies, she tells Kal that he has to use his power to save people, because it's the right thing to do. As Lois dies in his arms, Kal realizes what must be done. He must become Superman.
The culmination of the Superman storyline, in my opinion, was when he shows up in Flashpoint number 5, that final battle, and just lands on Enchantress and just says, "Stop."
That really got me excited. It was great to just see him finally in the battle. Flash, you know, turned to him to help, and he just sort of runs away.
But he more ran away because he didn't grow up in the world, so he was still scared, I guess.
Yeah, the scene where you see Superman for the first time as an adult, and the doors are sort of opening, and you're expecting to see the very strong, you know, Superman that we're used
to. The Man of Steel.
Exactly. Instead, you see this scrawny little guy, and he looks so pale in comparison to what you expect. And it's just kind of like, wow, this is, you know, it's a wow moment.
His story, including the tie-ins, is just so cool. Like, there's so many great moments he has when Cyborg and Batman and Flash break him out of his holding cell and he sees the sun for the first time. He's like, oh, it's beautiful. That's an incredible moment. And then he bails on them right there, just flies off. Another moment I really liked from the tie-in was when Lionel Luthor brings Lex Luthor to visit Project Superman and they go see Krypto and he kills Lex, which is just like, wow, Lex Luthor really didn't do anything in Flashpoint world. And that's also kind of tragic. It's like almost like his destiny is tied to Superman's.
I liked it how Lionel was the one that threw Lex in front of the dog, protecting himself. And that was kind of like shocking to see the difference in even Lane really took care of Superman. Like, he was a better father figure than I guess what Lionel was to Luthor. But if you look at how Superman grew up in the Prime Universe versus how he grew up here, I think that really shows you a lot about who he is, like, naturally. Because even after having gone through all he did, he still remained a good person.
I don't necessarily know if he would have remained good without even his circumstances in the Flashpoint world. In the tie-in, they really detail his relationship with Lois Lane, about how he met her once when she was a kid, and they had some bond that formed there. And I was thinking that's more what made him good in the end.
Well, I think it was the opposite of the other Subject Zero, which was the other Superman, you could say. And that guy believed in no attachments. But just seeing Lois once, he was able to develop a single attachment, and that helped him focus and become who he is and want to protect that single attachment that he had.
Scott Snyder did such a great job writing that tie-in. That final scene where Lois ends up dying in that massive fight with Subject Zero, and she even says, like, oh, this is such a cliche way to die, but it's just so sad to see Superman have to, like, let the one person he ever cared about, like, go.
I really like that he did mention that it was cliche. That kind of saved that scene for me. At the same time, it allowed it to be even more tragic. It had a lot of emotional weight.
I would completely agree with that. I think a lot of characters had really traumatic emotional experiences within this event. We already brought up Flash having to let go of his mother to restore the timeline. That's incredibly painful, but there were plenty of others.
Hal Jordan's tie-in plays up his relationship with Carol Ferris. As we know, Hal never received the Green Lantern ring, but was chosen by the president to lead an attack on the Amazons. Of course, the American fleet is attacked by invisible jets and destroyed. Hal still manages to drop his payload and dies destroying the shield protecting New Themyscira. Back home, Carol finds a ring Hal wanted to propose to her with. Dick Grayson's story is equally sad in that his parents are actually alive at the beginning of Flashpoint. While their circus tours Europe, Amazonians attack. His mother is instantly killed, and while everyone flees, his father also dies. Dick is once again left alone. Ollie Queen's one-shot has him as the CEO of Queen Industries, the top weapon supplier of the world. As an arms dealer, his compound comes under attack. Ollie fights back against the assassin, but ultimately finds out she is his daughter. Sadly, his security forces kill her before he can tell them to stand down. In the end, he is left only with his company.
Yeah, so Wayne Industries just doesn't even exist in the world of Flashpoint because the Waynes just stick with their gambling empire. Obviously, Thomas Wayne becomes Batman, as we've already said, but it's an incredibly emotional journey for him as well. He obviously is one of the main protagonists in this event. Cyborg actually turns to him for help at the beginning because he's the only way this coalition of metahumans can even form.
Everyone thinks that the Batman is invincible. And since Thomas Wayne is older, I assume for a lot of these people, he's basically been around forever.
But he rejects Cyborg at the beginning because he doesn't feel like it's worth it. He just wants the world to burn because he hates the world.
He's completely depressed.
But I think that's what's kind of cool is that Flash is actually the one who gives him hope, because telling him of this alternate future where Bruce is still alive, that's what actually, you know, turns him and makes him want to help the Flash. It's detailed a lot more in this incredible tie-in that he has, which is Batman Night of Vengeance.
The Night of Vengeance storyline takes place after the Flash first comes to Batman seeking help. At this point, Batman is mulling over whether he should help the Flash change the world to one where his son is alive.
The tale truly begins with the kidnapping of Judge Dent's two children by none other than the Joker. Batman heads to the sewers looking for a connection between the disappearance of vagrants and the Dent children. Though he finds the missing vagrants and an ornery killer croc, he finds no clues. Gordon, however, has more luck when he visits Selina Kyle, the Oracle. She is able to connect the dots between a gruesome murder of a man called John Randall and a missing pizzeria car. She guesses the Joker is holed up in Bristol Township in Wayne Manor. Worried for the sanity of his friend Thomas, Gordon heads there alone. Meanwhile, Batman conducts his own investigation on the newly discovered murdered body. Eventually, he finds a man who ingested pizza delivered by the Joker, allowing him to connect the dots and identify the body as John Randall's. But as Oracle informs him, he is hours behind Gordon on discovering this intel. Gordon has been inspecting the house, cautiously looking for the Joker. He finally sees his opportunity and he opens fire, catching the Joker unaware. But it's not really the Joker. Gordon shot the Dent girl in the chest, and as he desperately tries to save her, the real Joker slits his throat. An on-round Batman receives a mocking video of his dead friend. Enraged, Batman barges into his old house and screams, "What have you done this time, Martha?" He rushes to the dying child's side and uses his medical knowledge to try and save her. As he treats the child, he is reminded of his own. Memories from the past overwhelm him. He remembers how Bruce died in his care in Crime Alley all those years ago. How Martha could not get over her child's death. How he tried to make things right by personally seeing to Joe Chill. And how Martha finally smiled. As he reminisced, his and Joker's fight has spread to the grounds. They fight like the married couple they are. And eventually, talk turns to the past. Thomas asks the fateful question plaguing his mind. Would the world be a better place if he and Martha had died and not his son? Talk of change and a son's future that never was breaks Martha's psyche even further, and she runs, only to trip and fall and die.
Night of Vengeance was just such a great tie-in. It actually ended up winning an Eisner Award for Best Limited Series, and it really deserved it, in my opinion. It was really cool how not only is Thomas Wayne Batman, but Martha Wayne is actually the Joker.
It really provided a lot of insight into how this Batman is different than the Batman we're used to. He seems really depressed. He sees Martha's actions as the Joker as sort of his fault. And he's conflicted because he clearly still has feelings for Martha. And this leads to him being deadlier.
Yeah, actually, in terms of being deadly, we didn't really talk about it before. But he's actually the one who kills Reverse Flash with the great line, like, "If you have super speed, you really shouldn't stop moving during a fight."
Still very pragmatic, right?
Exactly.
Batman always keeps that trait. But getting back to his relationship with Martha, I found it very interesting that when he's dealing with the decision of, should I help the Flash, the person he turns to is still Martha.
Yeah, and she's like one of the few villains he hasn't killed. But when you talk about that decision about whether or not to help the Flash, that final conversation he has with her is like one of my favorite points of not just the Night of Vengeance tie-in, but the series in general. When he asks her, "If I could get Bruce back, should I, even if it means we're dead?" And she like regains sanity for a brief moment saying, "Yes, get him back." And then on the next page, though, she asks him, "What does Bruce do?" And then he says, "He takes after his father." And she's like, "A doctor?"
Unfortunately, another Batman. I liked that both their personas, which have been around for so long, the mythology has grown for Batman so long, that's why all these metahumans look up to him, and their spiral into depression and insanity has been going on for such a long time that at this point, both of them just want it to end.
I think it's also important to note the differences for the other kind of Gotham characters. Their lives seem to be worse without Bruce Wayne in it as well. Just to throw out some examples, Chief Gordon is no longer a police officer. He just works for a private security force for Thomas Wayne. He doesn't have any kids, so that means Barbara's never even alive. And Selina is actually the Oracle. She's been paralyzed. Sergeant Bullock and Renee Montoya actually run a dive bar since the police force no longer exists. And even villains like the Penguin, Cobblepot, he's reduced to kind of being Thomas Wayne's bitch, so his life is actually somewhat less happy as well.
Actually, the biggest lasting effect of this series into actually the New 52 is the letter from Thomas Wayne delivered by the Flash to Bruce.
Yeah, it was a really touching moment. It kind of fits with the same theme of Flashpoint being incredibly emotional. It's such a happy ending to Flashpoint number 5, and Bruce actually smiles, which he rarely does.
But it's also important to note some other Flashpoint tie-ins. First would be Booster Gold. As a time traveler, his memory isn't rewritten. When he arrives in Metropolis, the US government thinks he's an Atlantean soldier and sends Doomsday after him. Doomsday loses control, but Booster is able to defeat him before meeting up with the Flash for the final battle. Kid Flash is another character who doesn't have his memory rewritten. In his tie-in, he wakes up in the future where Brainiac controls the world. Realizing things aren't the way they should be, Bart runs through time collecting the Speed Force. In the end, he funnels all the power he has collected to Barry so he can set things right. Lois Lane and the Resistance follows Lois Lane after she survives the Atlantean attack on Europe. Cyborg gives her a mission to find and aid the Resistance, which she does. Although Lois's story finishes in Project Superman, her actions in this tie-in spur the Resistance to make a difference in the final battle. Canterbury Cricket features a new character who is part of the Resistance. His one-shot provides another perspective on their storyline. The Abin Sur tie-in features the Green Lantern crashing on Earth, but not dying. He decides he will aid the United States in hopes of promoting peace. In the final battle, he becomes the White Lantern and does his best to hold the planet together. The World of Flashpoint tie-in follows Tracy 13 as she tries to stop the conflict. The tie-in goes around the world showing what other DC characters are like in the Flashpoint timeline. Tracy checks in with the likes of Guy Gardner, Jon Stewart, Jason Todd, as well as others. Frankenstein's tie-in has the monster and other experiments coming out of years of stasis. The government initially tries to hunt them down, but in the end they all decide to work together and help out in the final battle. The Outsider tie-in features Michael Desai as he runs his criminal empire. The brutal leader has carved out a nation through blood. The Outsider goes up against the likes of Black Adam and the Martian Manhunter before joining Cyborg's team in the final battle. The Secret Seven tie-in shows what the magic users of the DC Universe are up to. Furthermore, the reader gets more insight into Enchantress and why she decides to side with the Amazons and kill Billy Batson. The Citizen Cold tie-in shows Captain Cold as the hero of the Gem Cities. Although the general public adores him, Iris West and her brother Wally see him for the thug he really is. Together with some help from the Rogues, they are able to take the criminal down. The Deathstroke tie-in shows the mercenary as a pirate who isn't actually motivated by greed. In order to survive, he has to be brutal, but he actually wants to find his lost daughter. Surprisingly, the story has a happy ending as the two are reunited at the end. The Reverse Flash also gets a one-shot that attempts to give a little more insight into why he hates the Flash so much. Gorilla Grodd also has a one-shot where he is the ruler of Africa and maintains his dominance through violence. However, he feels no one respects him and leads his army into the final battle in Flashpoint number 5.
Obviously, when looking at a massive event like Flashpoint, it's important to look at the ramifications of the event. We're now 2 years removed from Flashpoint, so let's see what's changed.
The biggest thing that came out of it was actually the New 52, and that was a universe-wide reset. At the time, there was a lot of mixed anticipation for this event, but 2 years down the line, I think we can pretty safely say it's been a very successful reset.
As we saw at the end of Flashpoint number 5, Pandora actually combined the Wildstorm and Vertigo comic universes with the DC universe, and the reset caused by Flashpoint allowed writers to completely retcon any aspect of any character.
I think let's take a look at some of the character specifics that really changed. Let's take a look at the big characters at least. First off, it's Superman, and he is not married to Lois Lane, and both of his parents have died. In the New 52, he is in a relationship with Wonder Woman, which has led to the events of Trinity War. And Wonder Woman herself has had a lot of changes as well. She now has a more mythological origin. She's the daughter of Zeus, and the Clay creation origin story has been completely retconned.
Flash, the big character of Flashpoint, has also changed quite a bit. He's no longer married to Iris West, and his one-time protege and sidekick, Wally West, has been completely removed from the DC Universe. Kid Flash, who also played an important role in Flashpoint, is no longer connected to Barry, but he is a member of the Teen Titans.
Another character, Batman, also had his Bat family changed, where Stephanie Brown has been completely retconned. Barbara Gordon now is not the Oracle and has the use of her legs back and is Batgirl again. But for the most part, Batman lore has stayed pretty much the same.
Green Arrow also changed a little bit. His son and protege, Connor Hawk, is now also out of existence. And Ollie now works out of Seattle instead of Star City. One corner of the DC Universe that remains almost completely unchanged is the Green Lantern section. It was also written by Jeff Johns, so maybe he didn't want to screw up his own work. Hal Jordan is obviously still the main Green Lantern. Kyle Rayner, who's one of the New Age heroes along with Wally West and Connor Hawke, is the only one of the three who actually survived the events of Flashpoint.
There's a lot of comic history that has been reworked or completely erased by Flashpoint that we can't really get into right now, but rest assured, Flashpoint changed a lot.
Outside of changing history, though, Flashpoint also did set up some of what we came to see in the New 52. Some of the character changes in the world of Flashpoint actually kind of carried over into the New 52. One example is Aquaman. Kind of the tough edge he got as Emperor Aquaman carried over into Geoff Johns' new ongoing series, Aquaman. He's a little bit more savage, has a little bit more of a bite to him, which makes him probably more interesting.
Another character I feel benefited from his role in Flashpoint was Cyborg, who was the American hero during Flashpoint and had a large role as the organizer of the forces. And he carries that importance over into the New 52 as part of the original Justice League.
Pandora, who popped up at the end of Flashpoint, has obviously become a pretty important character in the New 52 as well. She's kind of the main force behind the initial comic-wide events of the New 52, which is Trinity War. And that's actually going on in the summer of 2013, which is when we're filming this.
If you want to know more about Trinity War, be sure to check out our ongoing coverage.
Rest assured, though, Flashpoint was just a massive event with massive implications. And as we kind of wrap this video up, I think it'd be kind of cool to go over our favorite parts of the event in general. We also want to hear from you guys, so make sure you leave your own favorites that we go through in the comments below. But first up, what do you think your favorite moment is from this event?
My favorite moment is not from a particular comic. It's kind of like a moment in the entire event, and it was the sinking of Western Europe by the Atlanteans. I thought at that moment, that's when I really got hooked by this event, because that was such a huge thing to see, especially the tidal waves crashing down in a lot of these different series. And it really drew me in.
I'm going to say my favorite moment is when Flash first tries to recreate the conditions of him gaining the Speed Force, and he's on top of Wayne Manor, and he gets all the chemicals and the lightning to strike him, but it fails because you just think, like, man, is it over right here? I thought that was pretty good.
Let's now take a look at our favorite tie-ins. So we have to pick something excluding Batman, because I think both of us would agree that was our favorite one. What would you say?
I'm going to go Superman again here, actually. Say Project Superman was really good. The whole Lois Superman connection was pretty good, and it's kind of sad that that's the last time they're, like, soulmates, I guess, since in the New 52 it's now Superman and Wonder Woman.
I'm actually going to go with something that's kind of out of left field. I really liked the Outsider tie-in, and the Outsider in this one was an Indian-born guy that was kind of a mutant, almost, in a way, and he was just a really cool creation, I thought. He was very, like, wily, he was smart, and he was powerful, and he had a really cool showdown with Martian Manhunter, which I really enjoyed.
Yeah, that was a pretty good tie-in. Moving on, though, who was your favorite changed character in this world of Flashpoint?
I'm going to go with one that's actually pretty bold for me, because I've never been a big Superman fan, but I really enjoyed Superman in this. I was really rooting for him, probably more than anyone else in this entire event. And that moment at the end where he just charges in and tells everyone to stop, that got me so excited.
I'm going to say Aquaman was my favorite changed character. I kind of like how it actually carried over into the New 52. Emperor Aquaman, I liked his ferocity, and I liked he was just a warrior, and it's kind of cool. I would definitely recommend this event in general, though, as a must-read series.
I completely agree. Must-read. It has such a big effect on what's going on now, and it was such a great event.
Be sure to leave your guys' favorites to all those different categories we listed in the comments below. And if you like our video, give us a thumbs up.